All right. Hopefully everybody's face is in the right place. Looks correct. Welcome to the Veil One Shot, featuring the person who wrote the Veil, someone from Cyberpunk, somebody else from Cyberpunk, and someone from Winter's Edge, and myself. Don't worry. We'll go into more depth. We'll introduce them. It's a thing that'll happen. If this is your first time watching this channel, look at all these wonderful Twitter links underneath people's names. You can go to the Twitter, put those in, and see what those people are like, because they all have tabletop RPG shows or video game review things that they do. Isn't that amazing? This all-star cast we got here. Speaking of a person who is a star and a beautiful mind, let's talk to you, Chippinit. Who are you? What do you do?
Glad you asked, AP. Hi, guys. I'm Chippinit. Just as the name says, I don't know. I'm just a guy who does stuff on the internet. I mostly show up with Henley, AP, and Typicals Games whenever they decide to have me. I don't really do much on my own because I work a lot and I come home and I'm tired. But it's always a pleasure to be here. Thanks, Arthur.
I feel like you really fit in with tonight's game, actually. Speaking of someone who comes home after working a lot and then is tired, let's talk to you, Rich.
Nice segue. I like it.
Yes, someone like me who's perpetually tired. A lot of you know me from the Winter's Edge campaign that we were on actually just last night. And not much has gone on except I've been working since 3 o'clock in the morning, so I'm a little out of it. So you'll have to bear with me slightly. I'll do my best to try and muddle through and help keep things entertaining, but I make no promises right now. And I'm really happy to be here. I haven't played with any of these guys except Arthur, so I'm kind of excited. I always love playing with new people. It's always refreshing.
All right, cool. So speaking of someone who's refreshing, let's talk to the mastermind who created this game we'll be playing tonight. Go ahead, at the Veil RPG.
Hey, that's not me. That's I'm just Fraser Simons. Who knows who works that Twitter? Definitely not me. But yeah, thanks for inviting me. It'll be awesome to play with you guys. I've been watching lots of your campaigns. Hopefully,
it's true. You have been.
The RP as well, and not fail you all.
I don't think failing us is going to be a thing that happens because, as you know, in Cyberpunk settings, failure is not an option. We basically just want to have you, if you fail, you die, so, you know, just general stuff. Anyway, speaking of someone who both fails and dies, just kidding, he's done neither, even though he's been in the shit before. Let's talk to you, Typical GM.
You know who I am. I do tabletop stuff here. Arthur and I play on Mondays with Chip and Henley and Virgil, Zircon 5. So, really happy to be here. It's going to be another... a new game for me. I've never played the Veil before. Happy to be here with Fraser and Sid and Chip. And obviously, of course, the mastermind himself, Arthur Perkins from APGamingREAL. So just real excited to be able to play.
Right. I am, of course, Arthur Perkins, a.k.a. APGamingREAL. I run a bunch of games. You can find me here at this place that you're currently watching this on. Because whether it's on YouTube or Twitch, it's probably something that I did. So anyway, let's talk about the Veil. I mean, I don't know whether to throw it to you or not. All right, let me start with the touchstones that I did before I wanted to run this. All week, I've been preparing for cyberpunking, so I watched Inception, I reread Neuromancer, I reread Snow Crash. I mean, I just reread Snow Crash just for fun, because it's amazing. Yeah. Oh, I also watched your Jimbo, but that was just because I wanted some giri. Wanted some traditional Japanese stuff going on for me. Yeah, this is like a cyberpunk adventure that takes place in a digital future where it's not really clear what's real and what isn't, or what is ultra real, hyper real. What takes place on the internet only in the digiscape, and what takes place entirely in the physical realm. Anything you want to add to that, creator of the game, at Fraser Simons?
No, like, it can pretty much be whatever... It's built so that whatever touchstones that you want to make the game ends. That's what it is. So whatever everybody's touchstones here is, like, if everybody's watched Blade Runner, you can play Blade Runner. If everybody's watched Ghost in the Shell, play Ghost in the Shell, right? Or make up your own new kind of cyberpunk.
Perfect. Sounds good to me. So, let's talk about the assumptions. I mean, there's just, it's so wonderful that you wrote all of these nice things that I can read very quickly to the audience so that they know what the hell is going on. The veil, the basic moves, particularly lift the veil, assume that the protagonists are living in a world that is completely and always immersed in a kind of mixed or hybrid reality. This reality intermingles with the real physical world and the digital. This mixed reality means that characters in the setting can never be sure if what they're seeing is altered by the veil, or if it's even real at all, as it could exist purely in the veil only. The veil is also an informational and database suppository. It's like the internet of today, and a great deal can be found there. The veil is made possible because most characters in the setting, if not everyone in the fiction, have neurochips installed on their person. These chips are a person-machine interface and are always running by default. Next thing to talk about is the digiscape. The game assumes there are environments where a character in the setting can interact with a wholly artificial world and environment. When hacking into a computer, a character might enter cyberspace. When needing to talk to another player privately, said characters might interface through one another so as to interact in a private digiscape rather than in the real world. When hacking into a person's mind, a character might explore their target's psyche using technology designed to do so. The digiscape can be something like the Matrix, or it can be simulated psyche, a dream, or whatever else you decide. Cybernetics. All the playbooks, as well as some, I'm assuming it's supposed to be some moves, assume that the world and technology in it is advanced enough to support artificial mechanical limb augmentation and replacement. There's also something called Geary. The setting is assumed to have a system that places a great deal of value on obligation, honor, and face. And the final assumption is cred. There is a form of currency that works similar to the currency of today, though the systems that support the transfer or use of it may be more advanced or just different. So, we, together, will now design the game that we're about to play. Isn't that wild? Welcome to Powered by the Apocalypse if you've never been in one of these before. As a group, talk amongst each other and reach a consensus as to what type of environment you want to begin in. So we got a couple choices here on our nice worksheet. Mountains, coastal, riverine, glacial, ocean, alien. I have no idea what karst is. Desert, forest, urban, or other. What is karst?
Karst is like rocky, like areas like limestone, gypsum.
Oh, okay. All right.
Sinkholes and caves and stuff like that.
That would be a wild place. Listen, I've been watching Prince of Stride lately, which is an anime about parkour. And I was just thinking, man, that'd be a really sweet place to do some parkour. Yeah, so where do you guys envision this cool cyberpunk world of the future to be in?
I was thinking like hive stacks for some reason, like giant sprawling metropolises.
Now, when you say hive stacks, I think of like Warhammer 40K, yes, like exactly. Millions of people crammed into the smallest area possible.
Precisely.
Okay. Everyone That's down nice. For that?
Sure.
Oh, what if it's like a hive stack built in like the center of like a crack in the earth or something or other like that?
Oh, yeah.
So it's really like a lot of like layers.
Extinct
to the
volcano that they burrow down into.
Oh, and then there could be like subsections. So like, you know,
like cyber Iceland.
Yeah. So like only the iconoclasts live on like subsection 10, which is like closest to the surface or something other like that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Like the name drop iconoclast, nice.
Is this environment inhabited? We've got several choices here, such as we've never seen anyone else. There is the occasional human settlement. We've established a natural human population. We're overpopulated, or we're past the point where we could establish equilibrium.
Population out of control, 100%.
Is everyone okay with being out of control?
Sure.
I feel like I need to get my instantraparehorn.com. Just be like, we're out of control. Beep, beep, beep. Yeah. All right. So, yeah, we're going pretty hard on this Hive City, huh?
I'm going with it.
Cybernetics are considered taboo, ubiquitous. Well, I butchered that. Exclusive, fashionable, militarized, illegal, or other.
What do you guys think? I mean, I feel like fashionable, since people be pretty like desperately poor, that having any kind of working cybernetic to be a sign of wealth or connections.
I think it should be like a sliding scale. Like the closer to the surface you get, the more fashionable it is. But then as you get down lower, it's like more like junk militaristic, if you would.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like you get more discreet, more elegant prosthetics and cybernetics the closer you to the surface. And the further you go down, the more like orcish they become.
What do you think, Rich? I haven't heard a lot from you. Want to throw out?
I actually kind of, I'm actually feeling along the same lines as those two, because you know, the closer you get to the surface, the more affluent people get, so the more artistically designed the prosthetics could be, and more fashionably done. The lower down you get, the poorer, the cheaper, the cruder, probably.
You have to get your surplus Icelandic army. Wow. Amazing. All right. The regime, government, or bureaucracy of Cyber Iceland Volcano is a monarchy, a democracy, a fascist government, republic, aristocracy, dictatorship, or otherwise. And one that appears from Stars Without Numbers that I haven't seen here that I would be interested to see here would be a hydrocracy, where they control the government controls the water supply. Mm-hmm. And the person with the most water is in control of the population. I'm not saying for this specific setting. I've just always wanted to run a hydrocracy so I could have some like Colonel Sanders villain be like, well, if you wanted a glass of water, you should have paid for it.
I got a better idea. What if the reason why the city is in this volcano is because they managed to find, I guess, I don't know, crystals or something or other that emit a certain amount of light. So what if it's like a light?
Like a technocracy, so it's like the person who has the technology and the goods is in control.
Yeah, like so like the deeper you get, obviously it's gonna be really dark and there's electronic lighting, but it doesn't really do good. So they managed to find like these crystals or something else that's able to give off like a replicated almost like pure UV light or something other like that. That's just what I was thinking. That might be a little
everybody
too much.
Good with that?
How about a tech gerontocracy?
I don't know what that is. Explain it to me.
Gerontocracy is the oldest person's in charge.
So the oldest person with the most technology is in charge?
Well, the oldest person is in charge, but then to further cement their hold, they have the stranglehold upon the light of the city.
So is it that people are always trying to kill the oldest person so that the next oldest person is in charge until they...
I would imagine that's how things, like that's how the mulching process happens, is that the next person in line is going to try to secure assurances from those below them and also take care of the people above them.
Well, and that's why technology is so important, because the more advances in technology, the more their lifespan is extended.
You can have treatments like in Warhammer and...
So maybe like the veil for them is an escape to everlasting life and thus everlasting power.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Are they firmly in power, newly established, in disrepair, or all but eradicated?
I wonder, like newly established, like there's been a recent change in the leadership of the city, which may be what is spurring us to action.
Yeah. Like it was firmly intact, but then there was just a catastrophic moment that caused everything to change and everybody to just question, maybe.
Interesting.
So like the point of revolution, the tilting point.
The tilting point.
It's like you're standing on the edge of a volcano and you can fall in or fall down the side.
Yeah. Inheriting intensifies, and then we get to the tilting point.
All right. And this government, is it controlled by humans, a hive mind, something alien, or else?
Teched out humans.
Yeah, it's a tech/human, like.
All right.
So how old are these oldest people in the future? Like, do we...
You know, 60, 70, about that.
I would say, like, their exact ages are a closely guarded secret because they don't want people knowing. They don't want people knowing, like, they're next in line or whatever else, so...
I think I'm older than you, but I'm not sure. Better right, just and, kill you just in case. It's
weird, like, you know, you're trying to gauge somebody else's age, and that would give us a...
Wouldn't that lead to some really weird, like, samurai-style sit-downs where, like, two people sit down and they're like, I think you're older than me, and he's like, no, you are older than me, and so I must kill you first.
It's just, you have these casual name drops in conversation, like, oh yeah, I remember back in the water shortage of
18. I remember Aaron Burr.
Yeah.
Well, and that's why, like, the prosthetics and everything are so important, or, like, the technology to make yourself look younger, and just to live longer. But I guess, what do you think, guys, would be, like, a good age? Like, maybe 180 is the max a human has gotten without...
Pretty damn old.
I mean, something within a little bit of
reason.
That's
like some Moses level of old. All right, I can accept 180.
He came down to the volcano and he split apart the lava.
Yeah, so let's answer some questions about the setting. And if you guys don't want to answer any of these questions, just say skip and we'll skip past it because we don't need to answer all of them. What tone are we going for? What media are we using as our collective reference points?
Blade Runner? Warhammer 40K, Blade Runner?
Okay.
I mean,
that works for me.
Snack system.
I mean, I was thinking show tunes, but you know, I don't know.
Now I want this geriatric old man or woman running the place to be like the god emperor, and everyone's like, "We must give our lives to continue the emperor." But then everyone's secretly like, "But if we kill them, we might get his position."
Mm-hmm.
Is it kind of
AP? You're the MC. Don't say that. I'm going to have to go over there and kill you, you heretic.
What are creds in your world? What do they look like? And what markets... Well, what do markets and emporiums look like?
I'm imagining, again, the sliding scale of, like, the further down you go, the more, like, rust bucket, like, swap meet... Like, basically Alabama flea market.
I'll trade you a shotgun for that pile of food.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Well, there was, like, an idea that I had where it was basically a representation of a kind of caloric worth to somebody that equates to a energy cred. So when you think about your job.
Oh, yeah. So you're like, oh, you're worth, like, 200,000 kilocalories, you know.
Mm.
And that, well, I mean, it's like a literal conversion of energy credits. You know, if you have a very high caloric job or a very high thinking job, you know, that requires a lot of maintenance to your body. That's just how the world kind of adapted. Because I'm thinking that, like, the top of the volcano, that's where all the trade and import comes through.
Yeah.
And then down below, it just trickles down.
The old trickle down economy. Yeah, I got it.
Reaganomics.
In this case, the trickle down is light trickling down to prevent you from dying from vitamin D deficiency.
Can that be the currency, vitamin D?
The currency cred is literally like a 1 week ration of vitamin pills. What authority is there in this world, if at all? Are there police or vigilantes?
It's an elite squad called the Mellow Yellows.
No. Listen, we haven't even talked about the name of
the Sunny D's.
Typical's character, and as soon as that happens, the show is over. So let's just try to get as far along with this as possible without any Mellow Yellows.
I want to have you know this is a very ancient and honored name.
Okay, I'm sure. That's why you've been giggling about it for
like, I haven't been giggling. I love my character's name. It's a very respectable name.
Yeah.
I've been giggling about it a lot.
So do we have police or vigilantes of some kind, or is it literally just like order rules itself? Warhammer 40K style, like, or is there an Inquisition? Is there literally like the light Inquisition who finds people who are too pale and drags them out on the surface to like shoot them so they
what
they
if
don't
there
take
are
up
people
the
who are actually adapting to the low light environment and they're considered to be
like Morlocks.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so people go around like if you're not reactive to light, then they just fucking murder you.
Yeah, because you would upset the economy of the vitamin pills. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Are there clearly defined classes? What defines them, and what, if anything, visibly differentiates them?
Sounds skin tone.
Like, yep.
Skin tone.
Skin tone.
I rule over all you pasty motherfuckers.
It's the pasties versus the gangaroos.
It's not just about being old. It's also about your bronze level. Mm-hmm, exactly.
If you don't have radiant skin. If you're not copper tone, get out.
Yeah, I was going to say, copper tone showed up heavily in the book Ready Player One. What do cybernetics look like, and what are they made of? Are we talking like Shadowrun, where it's like digital ports on the side of your brain? Is it like Cyberpunk 2020, where your limbs are literally like, beep, boop, beep, boop, I shoot missiles out of my face?
I'd have to say that I think a lot of technology for cybernetics would have to be trying to mimic humanity more closely, so it's more aesthetic, because you don't want people knowing that you've had a lot of surgical replacements. You want to appear as young and as intact as possible.
Okay, so it's very flesh tone colored kind of...
Well, like at the top, you know, it's...
Ergonomic, aesthetically pleasing rather than militaristic or functional.
Yeah.
Okay. Everyone down with that?
Oh, yeah.
Sure.
Yep.
All right. What types of damage do your weapons do? What does armor look like, and what does it block? Do your weapons have names?
It's just straight up ultraviolet radiation. You just have sunburn.
You're literally like, pull out your sun pistol, and you're like, yeah. Suck on this. And somebody else is just like, taste the rainbow.
It's just sunburn guns, all it is.
Sunburn guns.
So what is armor literally just like high SPF you slather on yourself every morning?
I dig it.
God, this is gonna be a strange system. So yeah, when someone's like, yeah, I have 2 points of armor, I'm just imagining some dude at like a beach with incredibly heavy sunblock
the
everywhere.
On the nose.
Like, yeah.
It's SPF 20.
Yeah. All I hear is so there's this guy who plays with me named Jake, who also helped me like balance some stuff, and he's like you can't just give the players that, they'll just break it, like you just can't let them have that much fictional positioning over the setting. I was like, yeah, it'll be fine.
We're like, immediately make sunburn guns with sunscreen, right. Defense. Is there brand names to these weapons and armor? Are we literally like the copper tone kids with like Disney Amazon guns, also sponsored, like Colt, maybe like Smith & Wesson Colt makes a specific brand of UV gun.
Mark II refractive armor by Oakley.
Oh yeah, like sunglasses manufacturers. Yeah, they'd get in on this for sure.
I like that, but I just want one of us to have like an extremely powerful gun that's just called the Sunny D, and it's like a deagle that just shoots out a massive amount.
Oh man, it has like a Sunny D logo on the side. It can be an ancient weapon prototyped by a corporation long since destroyed.
They praise cooperation over all things.
Everyone is walking around in a mixed reality. How does this work in vague terms? Is it regulated somehow?
Maybe it's like asphyxed, if you would, to the main environment. So the deeper down you go, there's not that much of a... Like, if you don't have...
Oh, so it's like a processing thing. Like, the further down you go, the less you're, like, digitally in these beautiful environments, and you just look around and you're like, oh, I live in a volcanic shithole. Damn.
Well, no, like, think about it. Like, at the very top, it's very verbose, and the world is very brilliant.
Yeah, like, you
physically made that way.
Marble columns just looking out over an imaginary ocean.
Yeah, but when you, like, go down further and further, obviously they're not going to be spending the money on making things look
right.
Nice. It's just like a bunch of just straight concrete walls.
Oh, so is that like...
Once you have the veil over your eyes, you're looking at this, like, crazy techno neonscape.
Is the very center of this volcanic society, like, a server that goes down into the ground, and there's, like, less and less processor speed the further down you go?
Yeah. That'd be legit.
Like yeah. Yeah.
Cool. This is turning out to be like definitely the craziest setting I've ever been a part of.
Oh, and it's powered by UV light. and that's why it can't go down so far.
Oh, yeah. So the bottom would constantly be shutting down from, like, rolling blackouts?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The only safe means of leaving the digital environment immediately is through the architect move, the kick. How do people leave the digital world naturally? Are there phone lines you need to get to? A predetermined time that runs out and people get kicked once it's up? Is there a cost for coming out and going of some kind?
They take a vitamin C pill.
I don't know if I'm down with that. Listen. Listen.
Let's make a somewhat cool fiction.
I would like to say that it's...
What if there's like an implant or something? Everybody's implanted with these things, and it detects the amount of vitamin D you have in your body. And so the people who are rich on the surface who have a ton of vitamin D can stay in indefinitely. But people at the bottom have to really ration and plan out when and how they're going to enter or exit.
So what I'd love for there to be is like an MMO-style logout system. Like if you log out when you're in your own house, like... The place you go to sleep at night, you can log out immediately. But if you're, like, walking around, there's, like, a 30-second lockout timer for, like, PvP purposes.
Well, no.
You have really logged out due to inactivity.
Yeah.
Well, no, what if it was, like, a syncopic type of thing? I'm not saying that correctly. But it's, like, you have a virtual version of yourself and you have your physical version. And they're kind of synced up by that massive core. Yeah. But if there's a desync in progress, it could end up hurting you or affixing or doing something crazy to your emotional states. Like, if you log out in your bedroom and you wake up in your bedroom, you're fine. But if you're forced to log out, you're going to need to go back to that point or else suffer some sort of penalty.
I like that. That's pretty cool.
That's, like, this is just the actual digital world, though. Like if you're actually like jumping into completely digital space and not just in the hybrid space.
Oh. Well, I was thinking that like, what if the digital space was kind of formed around that core, if you would, that we have going down that sends energy throughout the rest of the city? And what if it somehow is transposed onto it, like the physical and the digital are kind of just affixed to each other and it's regulated by that core or whatever.
Sure, so there's, in this one, there won't be, like, a matrix thing to jump into. It'll just be, like, permeated everywhere.
Yeah, it's like, Shadowrun 5th Edition has, like, that ARG thing where you're constantly, if you've got, like, your goggles on, you can see, like, shops around you online.
Gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As people are noting, our good friend Seamus there needed to go and get some more UV radiation before he faded out. Using mixed reality, can you enter people's minds directly? And if so, can you enter their dreams?
Well, that'd be a really weird thing of like the syncopic I'm not saying it correctly. Just like, you know, if you manage to find somebody who's been transposed, maybe you could get access to whatever remains on the virtual side. So like if somebody's virtual avatar remains but their physical isn't there to like secure the connection, there might be just free data to access.
Maybe. I'm actually not a huge fan of this. Having just watched Inception, I was never a big like, I know it sounds weird, but I was like, dream within a dream. Yeah, it looks good on TV, but it's ridiculous to me.
Okay.
That's people fine. Are like, I'm going to go directly into your brain and in your dreams. I think I'd be down with minds, though, that you could, like, I mean, we talked about this already, that you could, like, mess with people's memories and, like, pull things out and edit them.
How about this? Like, looking further in the future, like, what if you can extract memories and store them externally from your mind? And that's one of the ways that the powerful and the elderly safeguard their identities and their actual age. And so one of the things we may have to do at some point.
Oh, you're like, yeah, no, you don't know how old I am. I pulled that knowledge from every living person. And you're like, but wait, I just checked the brain of your grandkid and you mentioned it at their third birthday party.
Exactly.
And they're like, no, how did you know I was born in 2017? No!
Well, what if that's also like, if somebody who's at the top knows that they're just going to die of either natural causes or whatever, and they kind of transpose their knowledge onto another one, giving them an almost false age, if you would, because it adds to their current knowledge that puts them beyond their years in a way. That might be neat.
Yeah, like someone trying to stay alive by being like, hey, buddy, let me just give you some hot tips real quick. Let me get in your brain.
I like it.
All right. How do you get around?
Elevators.
Does it make any sense at all to have transportation
I want to say sedan chair. Like Harvey definitely would have a sedan
chair. Oh, is this
carried around?
Was it Wally that had? I think that was the one. The movie Wally. No one. Okay.
No. I mean,
yeah. Where everyone was laying around on those repulsor lift beds.
Yeah.
No, I mean, like an actual chair that my like undercast servants carry around.
Oh, I was thinking maybe you were talking like Baron Harkonnen Dune floating.
No. I mean like the actual sedan chair, the vehicle. Where
oh, so you're Thorgrim Grudgebearer from Warhammer Total War.
That's who I am.
Yeah, you've got four guys with axes that carry you everywhere. Okay.
Oh, and don't forget elevators to get from floor to floor.
Okay, so basically the rich people are carried around in chairs, and the poor have to walk and use an elevator.
So everyone goes around on palanquins everywhere. Yeah,
it's a sign of status, because they are under the shade of your chair, so even as they are bearing you around, you are in the glorious sunlight above.
Wow.
Yeah.
Man. Your jams lead to a natural way in which all of you are linked and may know each other. So the way that you make money on a regular basis, does it work together? And I think we were going to do like a shady law company thing going down.
Mm-hmm. Sure, yeah. And I want to be the like PI that gets the info.
All right, cool.
I'm Kalinda from The Good Wife, except a man.
All right, so let's talk about these characters. Is there anyone that would like to volunteer to go first? Let's just run down the playbook and talk about what you can do and what that all means.
So I can go first if you want, because I already filled out all of mine, and then it might make sense for everybody else. All
right, cool. I mean, you're playing the Sildan class, so, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, and isn't it weird that it looks exactly like
her? It does look exactly like her. It's almost
freaky. Like the artist sent it to me, and I was like, what the?
Yep.
I'm the empath, and you assign your emotions like a D&D stat basis. So you have a 2, a 1, a 1, a 0, a 0, and a negative 1. And I've got 2 powerful, 1 peaceful, 1 joyful, scared 0, sad 0, minus 1 for mad. So if these circumstances come up within the fiction, I can kind of like gauge what my emotional reaction is going to be based on that. So if I obviously like probably have a temper, because I'm minus 1 mad. Yeah. So if Arthur throws some shit at me that makes me mad, I'm probably not going to deal with it so well. Every time I roll a stat for my emotion, I mark a little tick, and it says like what I could be feeling to the max with those ticks. So mad, below it says livid, and there's 5 ticks. And every time I trigger a move, I mark a tick in what I'm feeling. And that's for 2 reasons. It's to gauge like the emotional baggage for the person, as well as to color the scene so that everybody knows kind of like,
oh, trust me. When you mad, everyone knows you mad. We'd be trying so hard.
So the next spot is improvements. And the way it works is when you make your beliefs, you get improvements based on it being tested and it coming up in the fiction and resolving them and stuff, kind of like Burning Wheel. So I just hid those for now. And then my moves, I start with the absorb move, and I could choose one more.
Are all your moves actually based on your worst stat?
No. Like
they both say mad.
Yeah, but I can choose what emotion I'm being.
Oh, okay. All right. I was gonna be like, oh, snap. Playing on hard mode tonight, huh?
So if I'm doing absorb and I'm feeling peaceful, I just use the drop down menu to select peaceful and then roll it.
Cool.
Yeah. So I use what's called the flow to manipulate emotions around me and whatnot, and I can absorb it and then repurpose it. And I used I chose search feelings with it, which is basically like, if you've seen Hannibal, I can do like what Will does, where he goes to like a crime scene and reconstructs it and like kind of figure out what happened there and stuff, except using like emotional residue at the scene with my flow.
I feel someone was very salty here. They were upset. Yeah.
Someone was pissed. Cybernetics is usually what players have the most problems with, usually in the fiction, because you can literally just have whatever cybernetics you want, and usually that breaks people's minds. You just assign your tags to whatever you want. So if you look on your playbook sheet at the bottom, it says cybernetics, and I wanted hands that are dermalinked. And if you don't know what that means, it means that basically I can put my feelings through my skin, basically.
You can shoot emotions at people?
Well, I'd have to touch them, but I can't, like...
I see.
Shoot it.
And then some Dragon Ball Z.
Is susceptible, which I think makes sense. So if something touches me, like a virus or something, then I could, like, get it through my dermalinked hands, because it's a machine, right?
What you're saying is, if you fail on a move...
Yeah.
To, like, touch something and learn about it, you could, in fact, absorb people being mad through those hands.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then I also got chest. I just chose one armor. Makes sense. And I chose addicted. So I was thinking maybe there's some sort of thing that in order for cybernetics to keep being used, maybe I have to consume something to make it not be rejected.
Yeah, like sunscreen lotion. You have to regularly consume a brand of sunscreen lotion to keep that thing running, or that cybernetic will break.
Sure. And then gear, I chose a dermalinked neural net palm disruptor, which means that I can basically touch their face and stun them. But the downside is when I do it, I need to reload it every time. And it's disrupting means that, like, basically I can usually do it through their armor. And then I have a poison-tipped flechette magnum, which is two harm close area. So... like it basically shoots like a burst outwards, and same thing, I have to reload it, and the downside is that it's really loud.
Yeah,
so
you shoot some sick gamma rays at people.
I'll put in brackets, all of this is UV, I guess. and I have three creds that I start with, and I'm a PI, and I begin with one spike, which is what I use to do my emotion stuff. I haven't made beliefs yet, just because we're still talking about the settings, but you make three beliefs, and the idea is that the MC, AP, and myself are both working in a scene to get these things tested. So you want it to be something usually around another person in your party, so that you can kind of like rub up against that for drama. You want it to be a philosophical thing, so like, I don't kill people ever. And then AP will be like, how about this guy? He's a real asshole. And you'll be like, maybe I'll kill this guy.
There's a man who walks up to you. He's dying of vitamin D deficiency and is asking you to put your gun to his head and kill him before he dies a horrible, slow death. He's
and then
crying, and his grandchildren are looking on, begging you to do it.
There you go. And then if that comes up and it gets tested, you get XP. If you resolve it, you get XP. Anytime it comes up, basically, you get rewarded for it, and that's how you advance in the Veil. And then the last one, you probably want it around the like goal that you want to do that session. So if you're like, I'm going to go do a heist, maybe the resolution is I do that heist kind of thing, or a belief about it. So like, when we do this heist, I don't want to kill anybody or whatever, you know. Something like that. Just three beliefs that you think will come up in the fiction as often as possible so that it gets you XP.
So if there's one thing I learned playing The Sprawl with Adam Coble, it's to wait for someone else to write a belief and then to write the exact opposite belief to make sure that person never gets any XP. I got cock-blocked so hard. you've told us a lot mechanically about your character, but let's hear about you as a person, Kip.
Yeah, so I am, I think, 5'9"-ish. I've got a picture of myself up on my profile there, except I obviously don't have, like, a glowing glob of stuff, probably.
Mercury or something.
Yeah. But that's what I envision myself looking like. And the outlook on life is going to be on my playbook, my, let's see, my burden is, so ever since you could remember, you've had to give up a piece of yourself to others. When they hurt, so do you. You share the burden of being on everyone's emotional roller coaster ride. Sharing the triumphs and the tragedies of humanity puts a great weight on your shoulders, knowing that for what do you strive? And I think that I look out for number one. People always leave.
Yep. Throw so much salt at you. People are going to be like, don't leave me. Don't leave me. No.
Yeah. And then for the flow is the energy you get when you absorb emotion spikes, as well as the interface for your abilities. When you charge objects, recreate past events, or interact with emotions, it's all through the flow. Choose one thing it does for you. I'm going to do charged object. And then on page two, it says I get absorb and choose one more move. So I now have absorb, charge object, and whatever I just said, search feelings.
Yep, search feelings.
Yeah, so now I have all that. So I just copy and paste that into my character sheet. And then I'm done.
Tell us more about Kip. We know Kip is a PI.
Yeah. And with that outlet, I think he's just like really, let's see. He's feeling powerful, so he probably doesn't like to talk a lot about his feelings and stuff, even though it's his like bag or jam to do that. He looks out for number one, so probably has few friends. He probably is like a dick to people to keep them like far away from him, kind of thing.
You're Jessica Jones now, and
yeah, there we go. That's a good touchstone.
Got it.
Just all right. In Luke Cage.
Speaking of people who do stuff, anybody else want to introduce their character? Typical. You want to? I don't want to put you on the spot, but I feel like the sooner we get your name out of the way.
I don't understand why Harvey Glasscock is such a taboo name. As I've mentioned many, many times, it is a name associated with great prestige and nobility.
I don't disagree with you on any... listen, I know the audience. They're going to be cracking up.
All right. Well, it's Harvey Glasscock. I don't know anything about making characters in this setting, so hopefully Fraser will be able to help me out with this. What is the stat array that we get?
You're muted, Fraser.
You get plus two, one, one, zero, zero, minus one.
Yeah. Two, one, one, zero, minus one. Okay.
When you're putting it in the character sheet, it's important not to put the plus. Only the negative needs a minus. Everything else, just put in the numbers, or it will not roll properly.
So my character, Harvey Glasscock, he is, I imagine him not to be an actual attorney, more of like a concierge, somebody who takes care of things for powerful people. And so I have him with a two in the powerful emotion. I have him as with a one in both mad and scared, because oftentimes I see him being placed in situations that are beyond his ability to cope with. Like, he's being asked to do things by very powerful people. If they don't get done, he's going to get fucked up. So he either gets mad or he gets afraid of the outcome of these two things. He has a minus one to both joyful and sad. He's is this jaded, like destroyed amalgam of he wants to wield his power over other people, and he gets a chance to do that very often in his occupation. But at the same time, all the happiness, all the emotion in his life is sucked out by these soulless automatons over him telling him to do this.
You don't have two negative ones, so you just have one negative one.
Can I have two negative ones if I want them?
Sure. I like
just like, yep, I knew we were going to play on hard mode in some way tonight, so it's typical.
He is not a happy person, nor is he a sad person. All he's concerned with is getting more shekels. All he wants is more than vitamin D pills, all right? He believes that once he acquires enough vitamin D, piles up enough of these, that he will be able to buy his way into the icon class, upper tier of society. Which leads me to my beliefs, which is that always acquire vitamin D pills, no matter the cost. No matter what the cost is to myself or to the people around me, always vitamin D pills. So get that D. all the time.
God damn.
I'm just putting it as get that D. I know what it means. Let's see.
I mean, so if you spend the session attempting to acquire D, you will for sure get a belief point.
Okay.
I don't think you can ever resolve that, since you say get that D all the time. You would literally always be chasing the D.
No matter how much D I get, no matter how big the individual deposit of D is, it's never going to be able to satiate this guy.
You see why I wanted to just get the giggles out with Harvey Glasscock here?
All right. So I need three beliefs, right?
More than you do.
It can't just be get the D. Yep. All right. Well, let's see what else. I think he's kind of he's kind of a vain guy. He has no reason to be. I consider him to be very average physically. He has probably a good force of personality. He's an executive who needs to get his way. So I feel like his vanity is going to be something that's going to be tested a lot. Like, any chance he gets to make himself appear better than he really is, the way he can talk himself up. So he's very vainglorious. So getting that V is going to be his number two.
To talk myself up is a belief.
Yeah, getting the vainglory going, getting the V is definitely going to be number two on this list of beliefs.
All right. Before you set a third belief, we might want to talk about what the opening mission is, just so that you can try to resolve it before the end of the session.
Okay. What else do I need for this character?
You have a board, right? Can you read the board move, and then let's figure out what's going on there.
My executive board over here.
Yep.
I'm playing an executive. I'm a cog in the machine that is the corporation that I work for. Although powerful, I answer to them and their agenda first, and then my own. So their intentions will affect which contracts I get from them based on their own desires.
All right, so you have to choose one of the agendas. Okay. You have one in mind.
Anytime anything is lucrative, no matter the affiliations, they take it.
Perfect. So they're... Much like you, they are attempting to get all of the D's.
They need as much D as they can possibly get. Absolutely. Board agenda, there we go.
All right, and then beneath that, there's a second set of options to pick from. One of the following is also true.
Okay. One of the following, they want to take down other immoral corporations. Yeah, right. They use the corporation to further their own political motivations. That's definitely one we can come back to. They're trying to revitalize. They are in the middle. They're the middlemen between mega corporations. I would say maybe being the middlemen between like the mega families. That would be something that makes sense. Like,
okay. So your corporation is literally like the mafia then. They're literally the ones yo, holsters, you stay over there. McCoys, you sit in your corner. Stop. Stop. Bad McCoys. Bad.
Yeah, I feel like
there's also the last option too, Hank.
Mysterious secondary interests. I'm good with that too. It's whatever.
You want to start a cult within the...
I imagine there would be a cult. There'd be a cult of these like Morlocks in the deep warrens of the Megastack.
Is that why the corporation is so intent on acquiring vitamin D, so that when the Morlocks rise up, they have control of the economy? They can just be like, look, we own everything now. The Morlocks are in charge. Just too bad. Your power. How did you obtain this grandiose position, and how did it all come to be?
How did I imagine it was... I was born into the family business. I don't think that he is either smart enough or ambitious enough. Smart enough or capable enough to actually climb as high as he has on his own. So I feel like it was definitely nepotism.
Excellent. How many moves do you get to pick? You get to pick any? You start.
Yeah, he gets one more. He gets quarterlies and TPS reports and choose one more.
Are you picking the move called Harvey Time?
Is that the one I can pick? Oh, yeah, I already put Harvey Time down.
Why don't you go ahead and read that one?
All right, so Harvey Time is when you have time, solitude, and offer someone cred in the pursuit of completing any contract you don't intend to pursue yourself, roll and add however much cred you wish to spend. On a 10+, choose 3 of the following. They complete the contract. The board does not hear that you've been pursuing your own interests. You get paid in full for completion of your contract, and the contract is not a setup or an ambush. Yeah, that's definitely what I'm taking.
I like the one that gets set up or an ambush. I mean, If you don't take it, it's totally going to be.
Wait, I only get one of these. I wanted Money Talks too. I really like Money Talks.
I mean, all you got to do is get very emotional throughout the setting and get lots of beliefs done, right? So
I will be going after the D and the V as hard as I possibly can this entire game. Like,
understood.
Nothing will keep me from it.
I understand your intentions, sir. Okay. Let's talk about your gear.
I have no idea about the gear of the setting.
Well, I mean, look at this nice gear chart we have right here.
Oh, that's yeah. I want the searing sawed-off shotgun. I want the.
What does that look like in ultraviolet gun terms? It's
just like a big stupid alien ray gun, like blaster, with like a megaphone cone on the end to help channel and project the UV rays.
Somehow, I feel like the setting arose out of like a paranoia campaign gone wrong. Yeah. Do you have any cybernetics you want to start with?
I would imagine he is trying to hoard all of his D to get as much cybernetics as possible, because that's a sign of prestige within.
Okay.
This.
Well, I mean, you can choose positive and negative tags for all of them.
Okay. So. What's a positive tag?
It's on the reference sheet.
Or look at the catable list too. It's on the first page of the catable.
Possible tags. All right, I'm looking. I'll come back to that. That's okay.
Okay. Yeah. Sure. Right. You'll have plenty of time during
everyone else's.
Everybody else's.
Is there anything else that I need?
Let's talk about what you look like.
Oh yeah. Okay. So I have this done. Like I mentioned, he's not a very imposing physical specimen. He's probably like 5'4", 5'5". Very soft. Like he eats too much rich food. So very soft skin. Very rounded features. Sort of hunched-shouldered, paunched belly. Dressed in the finest silks and velvets. Actually, I would imagine would showing more skin be more of a status symbol?
You gotta absorb the D, right?
Exactly. So. You gotta get as much D as possible. So like I imagine it's not anything other than just like a very nice, very brief, like silk banana hammock, like over the shoulder, like Borat style banana hammock.
You got to show off also, you know, how much the D has affected you. So, you know, if you're just, if you look like you've been pumped full of the D,
you got to advertise. All right. Yeah, people need to know they're dealing with Harvey Glasscock Esquire.
He has a silk banana hammock. Got it. Ladies, if you want to fan art this, men, you get in on that too.
Yep. Don't judge you.
I feel like we got to have like a fan art pick. That's like all four members just like turning around and showing their butts, which will show how much they're wearing and how much D they get.
Okay, like I said, this guy has he's very short, like 5'5", like I said, sort of soft features, very soft skin everywhere, sort of flowing, very greasy, very very hairless body. Plain features. I'd say if I was going with any kind of race, I'd probably go something with like, I don't know, like Balkan region, like Eastern European. And so to be hairless, he has to wax constantly.
He's got to absorb the max amount of sunlight.
Exactly. The hair, like the thick mat of chest hair, is blocking more sunlight into his skin.
I get it.
Not to mention in a, you know, scenario of forums, you need to have a lot of space to apply that SPF 40 to.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, yeah.
This is not what I was expecting.
I think we've got everything here from you. I mean, obviously we'll come back when we do the final beliefs and geary for everybody.
Sure.
What is your jam? How do you make money?
I make money by making contacts and dealing with sensitive negotiations for this mega corporation who deals with all of the highest tiered families.
Do we have a name for this corporation?
Mon Joja.
Arasaka Associates.
Arasaka and Associates.
Yeah. Oh no! I was I actually had a name for this. It was going to be.
I mean, it's a you were born into this business. Is it like Glasscock and Associates?
It's gonna be here. I'll type it out. It's gonna be Mizugumi, Shekelstein, and Glasscock.
Oh god! I knew Glasscock was gonna be tacked in there somewhere.
Glasscock.
As soon as you started listing names, I was like, "Yep, it's Glasscock time."
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did you type that out somewhere? Oh, yeah, you did.
420 chat.
You know, I was so sure, right? Because the setting has so much, like, Japanese stuff. I was so sure that you'd be getting your mission from, like, an old Japanese man. And now
Mizugumi.
Mr. Mizugumi is just going to be like, Wakari Masenka. Yeah. Who wants to go next?
I'll go next, I guess.
All right, Seamus, let's talk about you.
So Seamus Hartwick is an honor bound, which is they're basically, I guess the closest thing you could come up with would be some form of samurai.
Yeah, you're a street samurai for sure.
And so with the stat array, that was a 2-3-1-0-1, right?
2-1-1-0-0-1.
Oh, two zeros. Okay.
So wow, you pick powerful too. Okay, we got a bunch of people who like feeling powerful all the time.
So yeah, I picked a powerful of 2, peaceful and mad are at 1, sad and scared are at 0, and joyful is definitely at a -1. Seamus is you're very, I guess you could say, a very stereotypical street samurai, oriental, about 5'6". He wears a armored body glove top and, you know, military style cargo pants. For his gear, I chose the ancient masterwork sword. And for his backup weapon, I picked the Flechette SMG.
So we've established that guns tend to be like EM... radiation guns. Is that still true for you, or do you actually, like, literally, you're the only person in the whole world that carries an actual gun to shoot people with?
Actual gun.
All right. is there any chance your sword is like a UV lightsaber?
I could go along with that.
It's a masterwork. It's a more elegant weapon for a more civilized time.
And it's AP.
Yeah, it's armor piercing. It's the best.
Yeah.
A sufficient way to give the D to somebody.
Yeah, so you start with the Geary move there. Why don't you tell us about that?
The Geary move.
Upper left-hand part of the character sheet.
Oop, wrong PDF here. Let's see. Yeah, I'm the enforcer for the institute or organization that upholds the Geary. When someone needs debts owed to them taken care of, it is my task to which it falls to. So basically, I'm the corporate hitman.
And you work for the same company as Harvey Glasscock? Is that how we all know?
No, absolutely.
All right, yeah, you're the trigger man then.
I'm the person they send in when Harvey Glasscock fails.
Whoa.
I feel like that's pretty often then. Get a lot of work.
When that glass cock shatters, you know, you just got to bring in your D-saber.
Wow. We are doing so good at making dick jokes all night long. Yeah, so the place you work for is unique for what reason?
It is the it's unique because it is the only authority for people wanting to resolve Geary.
So all of these families, these Iceland cyber families, literally have to work through your people to resolve monetary things or Geary things. So like when someone's like, oh shit, this dude just, you know, like insulted me at a party, they go to Mizugumi, Shekelstein, and Glasscock, and they're like, listen, this dude insulted me, he has a debt with me now, I need you to fuck him up. Awesome. It is revered for what reason?
Let's see. Ooh, what did I put down? It is a tradition that people bring their disputes and problems to us.
Excellent. Tell us what the surroundings and atmosphere of this area is. Oh, you have a lot of control over the environment.
Yeah. Let's see. So this is choose 3 to 5. So hollow screens, definitely.
Ooh.
And to show off our large S, we have a grove of trees. And with the non-mechanical life, free-flowing water, And let's see, mirrors everywhere.
Wow. Oh man, and so when you're like on the high levels and everything is all like cybered out, you don't notice it. But when you get on all the low levels, there's mirrors everywhere and you're like, oh no, I don't have enough of a tan. Yeah. They put the mirrors up so people can look at their own ugly, untanned faces.
Plus the mirrors help to refract whatever light is in them.
Oh yeah, that's a good point, yeah. What precious light remains. Many people have come here over time, and some of them have chosen to be your friends. I mean, who are these people, and what do they do?
Let's see. Detail through them with a name. Ooh.
I mean, Case the Hacker, Trinity, the girlfriend, and I don't recognize any of the other names.
Let's see, detail three of them with a name. So, yeah, I'll definitely take a hacker. And we'll name him Bartleby.
Yes, of course. I'll make sure to get unhacking that right away.
I want him to sound like Jarvis from... Avengers.
Oh yeah. And also take a weapons merchant as a friend.
He's the one person that can sell you actual guns.
He's the one that can actually supply me with my ammo.
He's got like four pistols that he cleans constantly. He's like, "Oh, you need a Smith & Wesson? We've got exactly one of those."
And of course, we'll just have to do a cheesy name for that, like Remington.
I mean, his name could have just been Smith Weston.
But... could have been Samuel, like Samuel Colt.
Ooh, yeah, Samuel Colt. His name is P90.
P90.
P90. Last name, X.
No, his name is Op.
Op. Oh, his name is Op, get a wheel gun. No one knows where it came from.
And I will also, for the third one, we'll have a female honor-bound companion, probably someone who works for the same company. And I don't know. What should we name her?
I mean,
Trinity. I'm horrible with choosing names.
Trinity.
All right, Trinity will work.
This is the cyber future. The girlfriend is always named Trinity.
Name her Cavassier. Like, Cavassier. Let's go with this straight stripper name.
The long history of humanity choosing alcohol names. My name's Samuel Whiskey. All society feel the obligation of Geary at one time or another. You didn't create these penalties for breaking honor debts, but it's your responsibility to enforce them. What circumstances generate Geary in society, and what are the penalties for breaking them?
Let's see. Well, definitely if you offend someone's honor.
Ooh, honor is going to be pretty important then.
And the penalties would be, if you offend someone's honor, forced labor.
Wow, that would have worked out great for Alexander Hamilton.
Smile about it.
I mean, I was just listening to the Hamilton rap that ends with the duel between him and right? And if they had just been like, "Oh, you got to go do some hard labor instead of getting shot in the face," I feel like it would have been a really different story.
If you make a mistake that harms another, you get public humiliation.
Okay.
And when a mutual agreement is broken, imprisonment.
All right.
So, like, if someone violates a contract or something like that, they get thrown in jail.
Okay.
The scenarios that I think even the first one that I made, one of the players chose, when you tell someone an important truth and then they like break that gearing, it's death.
Yeah. Listen, I had an affair with my wife last night. 10 seconds later, you tweeted that? Death. I'm calling the cops on you. So you start with the moves Honor and Bound.
Yes.
You also get to pick another move.
And then he needs to pick why he does this too.
Oh, I missed that. Where was that at?
Just right below Geary. It says,
oh, Geary, why is it important for you to do this? Yep, you're right.
And you can always make your own too. Those are just to get the ball rolling.
Yeah, I'll just pick one. I owe it to society or my own honor that these things be done. So very honored.
It's tradition. This is how it's always been done. So why wouldn't you do it this way? Yeah, let's talk about what move you would like.
Let's see. So I think I'll take skilled.
Okay. You want to read that off for us?
Skilled is when you are outnumbered and neutralized, you generate an additional +1 hold on a hit.
Yeah, so you're good at shooting people when the heat is on. When the heat is on, you pull out your actual pistol and shoot people in the face really well. what are your beliefs?
So far, I just picked two beliefs because I wanted to wait on the third one. Mm-hmm. The first one is service is life. Means basically because my character is all about the honor that his entire sole purpose is serving the company. And my second belief is I care not for the D.
That's a rough one, right? That's literally it's like being like, I don't give a shit about money. All I care about is societal obligation.
Yeah.
Okay.
Maybe like focus it a little bit more so it's going to rub up against something in like play though. So like,
I feel like there could have been better chosen phrasing than that. But yeah. I mean, listen, if you want to rub up against the D, that's your own choice.
But yeah, like I just mean, I hate how Harvey is so into the D. Or I'll show Harvey that there's more to life than the D.
So that's something to think about, is making something that specifically relates to another player.
Well, I figured that would relate very well because we're in, you know, Harvey's character, and you know, we're in very much a situation where the D is all important and my character gives zero shits.
Well, speaking of that D, how do you make your money? You enforce the Geary, but how specifically do you do it? I mean, when we say trigger man, are you like the guy that knocks on someone's house and is like, pay your debts? Or are you the guy that knocks on somebody's house and like removes their couch and shoots them in the face and then calls the like cleanup crew and is like, there's a guy with a shot face, remove him or I'm coming for you?
Definitely very much a hitman. So okay.
So they only call you when it's very serious. Otherwise, there'd be a trail of bodies.
Yeah, they only call me when someone actually needs to die.
Are you like the professional though, or are you like John? What's that newest one with Keanu Reeves? Yeah.
No, since he uses a real gun for this, he's only brought in when the D is not powerful enough.
Oh, yeah, he's like a Morlock hunter, too, because they wouldn't be affected by D weapons, because they're just like, hey, your D doesn't work on me.
Yeah, he's just like,
this does.
They're like, what's that? I've never seen a weapon that looks like that before, and then their brains are on the wall behind them, and they're like, I can't talk, I'm dead.
Yeah. And it's a flechette, so you can be like, it's French.
Yeah.
it sounds like you picked your gear already. right?
Yep. The Ancient Masterwork Sword and Flechette SMG.
And you already detailed your armor, so sweet. 2 cred, and you get 2 crit. And then cybernetics.
Do you have any cybernetics you want to pick up?
Cybernetic arm.
Cool. What's that about?
It is scarred.
But what,
so maybe I, like,
but what does it do for like, you?
Sorry?
What's the positive thing it does for you?
There's a positive?
Yeah.
You
get to pick
powerful.
At least one large tag. And...
So, like, what do you envision doing with the arm the most?
Probably enhanced speed and strength. That's probably my sword arm.
Okay. How about compensating? Helps to correct human error. Could remove recoil or compensate for person's heartbeat or
problem. Compensating would probably be good. Means I use an actual gun with recoil.
Listen, people are always worried about why he doesn't want the deal, but he's just compensating.
Or responsive to, reliable, intuitive to use, durable, hard to break, long lasting, integrated, detachable.
I feel like having, listen, if you have a cyber arm, I think you really want it to be hard to break. Otherwise, you just have a hunk of metal.
Well, and like fictionally speaking, that arm would like, you know, it'd be that arm where you could punch through like a metal.
It would also be that one guy in every anime that's got the one cyber arm, and they block all the blows with it, so their whole fighting style. And then someone's just like, I'm going to try to make you fight on your right side.
Yep, or that. But yeah, or you can make up whatever tag you want. All the tags are just like stuff that, you know, I thought.
Narrative, really?
Yeah, but it could be anything that you want. I just tried to cover all the bases. Who knows?
Yeah, I think I'll take compensating.
All right, cool.
Clearly compensating for something.
Exactly.
It says glass.
Compensating for a lack of the D.
Anything?
Glasscock leaves it all out there. Anybody can see what he's working with.
Jesus. Anything else we need to cover with your character? I think that's just about everything except for Geary.
Yeah.
All right, Chip. You're our special snowflake tonight.
Yep. So, I'm playing an apparatus known as 2.0 in celebration of the Veil 2.0. And what that means is I'm just like that iRobot cyborg that has consciousness and doesn't know much of anything. So I figured, so one of the things that it says for me, and we can do this at the end of going over my character, it talks about I need to ask some questions. And since this is a one-shot, I thought it might be cool to ask each of you a question as the MC and the three characters. And then that's a way to get our characters solidified and whatnot. Do you think that's cool?
Yeah,
sure.
Okay, so for stats, I want to be a special snowflake, as well as Mr. Glasscock over there. And I want to have a straight 0 in everything.
Well, actually, the empath only gets 1 stat.
They only start with 1, but that's what I'm talking about, is I want it to be a straight 0.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. You know, just starting from the ground up, there has to be some type of improvement to get those stats up. And I think I'm going to start with peaceful. I feel like that's a good one to have. Let's see. As far as my beliefs, I thought it might be really cool to go with Asimov's laws. So I went with, I may not injure a human being or through inaction allow a human being to come to harm.
You're not going to start with the 0 with?
What?
The 0 with law?
I don't remember that one.
It's from the Foundation series. Don't worry about it. It's way deep in Asimov's writing.
I will have to read that. You'll have to send me a message.
It's a good one.
The second belief being, I must obey orders given by human beings, except when such orders conflict with the first, and I must protect my own existence as long as its protection does not conflict with the first or second law. I thought that'd be an interesting way to have to play. Like, those were programmed into me, and that's how I'm, that's just what I believe from the get-go, until it's they're like, challenged.
It's gonna be like, I'm a robot in a volcano.
I volcano?
Yeah.
For cybernetics, a lot of these I just chose the default ones, but the way that I envision my character is all cybernetics, if you would, because they're a robot, basically, or some mix between. The only thing that I really cared about was, I thought I have, so for the head, I had HUD, amplification and magnification, and then scarred. Ear, recording, dampening, intercepting, scarred, arm, compensating, scarred, leg, compensating, scarred, interface, encrypted, scarred, chest, storage, non-functioning, I'll get into that, skin, and then this is just an additional one that I added in, skin with a tone shift, so if I'm around pale people, I appear pale, if I'm around really tan people like Mr. Glasscock, I appear really tan, and then some photosynthesis, and then torn. So what my idea was is that when I was made, you know, I didn't have like all this stuff going on, but in all of the trials that we'll figure out, I have been thoroughly damaged. So while I look mostly human, you're going to see like rips and tears in my arm and my skin and stuff like that. But you're going to see like the, you know, I guess the D veins going underneath where they're glowing with that kind of like UV radiation or that UV kind of orange sunny D light.
Something to note, if you're going that way and we're going with that whole like, corporation is trying to get you back or whatever, then maybe you're branded, tell the MC you're hunted and take no negative tags for all your cybernetics.
Oh, that'd be cool. Yeah, like what I did
back, son.
Was for describing my vessel, I took appears mostly human underneath armored so that, I mean, you don't want the whatever. I just figured that my character would be more or less resistant to the UV radiation. Within a new life form, tracked by your maker, unknown to you, and when you meet them, 5 XP. So it may be that situation of I wake up in an alley and I don't know how I got here. So I might still be hunted by my maker for whatever reason, but it's just unknown to me at the moment.
Sure.
And then look, I went with androgynous discreet wear. So just, I guess, form-fitting, like black or white clothes that just kind of cover up where I'm just torn and battle-worn. Narrow face, kind of unnerving eyes where they're, I guess mechanical would be a better term, where they're replicated eyes. So when you look for them for emotion, you're not going to find any right off the bat, at least. Average body, and then I guess just a Caucasian build. So I was made to blend in, if you would, or to be a new life form meant to experience life in a way.
He's an infiltration unit gone rogue.
He's a replicant.
Without knowing it.
Yeah.
So
can we talk about your vessel?
Yeah, I just did. Appears mostly human.
Yep. Underneath, you're branded.
Armored, I chose.
Armored, okay. Your essence is?
A new life form, tracked by your maker, excellent. Unknown to you.
All right, I was writing so much stuff down, I didn't get to track all of it.
I have it all written down in my character sheet if you'd like to look.
I've already invented a bad guy. His name is John Baptiste Ulrich Jr., and he wants you back.
Jesus, okay. So,
can we talk about your birth?
Yeah, is that
yeah, what, so this is where the fun kind of gets in, and I guess I start rolling dice, but I figured that I would ask like 4 questions, one to each of you, and then I either choose the answer or it, however it works.
Yeah, so if you get a hit, then you answer it. Otherwise, we answer it for you.
Cool. Beans. He wants to be first.
I'll be first.
Okie doke. So I just roll 2d6. 2. Yep.
2?
Okay.
Well, double ones. Good thing to get out of that.
I ask a question. No, on a miss, Chip asks a question and you will answer it, Kip.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Oh, these are all two good ones. I'll ask the big important one. Why am I no longer with the people who created me?
You were malfunctioning. Or at least not acting the way that you were intended to act.
So like I was discarded?
Yeah, or like maybe they... Yeah, like I think that
you were a killbot and all you wanted to do was hang out with birds.
Yeah, I think the most important part of it would just be the reason is that you're malfunctioning and then the rest would be nebulous for your other questions.
Okay, so more or less malfunctioning and disregarded and then I kind of came to consciousness and my makers are unaware that they thought I was just like thrown in the trash or something like that.
Oh, maybe. Check out your other questions with the other people, and then we'll see.
Cool beans. Who's next?
I'll go next. Asking questions.
Right. You're asking the question.
What is my purpose?
What is your purpose? You are built as a prototype for, we're talking about downloading people's memories into. You're built as a prototype for one of the elders or one of the powerful families to download their memories into so they can live forever.
So I'm like a prototype cyber brain vessel.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually pretty cool.
You all are right. The singularity.
Oh, all right, Sid. Was I created in the image of someone?
No. You were, your form was given, you know, it was more function over function over fantasy.
All right, Victor. Okay. Victor. Nobody plays League of Legends?
Function. I know what you're talking about. 7. So that's still a miss, right?
No, 7's good. It's a hit.
Oh, cool. So, Arthur, that's you asking me a question?
Yeah, and you answer it.
Cool.
What is your purpose?
I already had that answered.
Yeah.
I'm a prototype cyber brain vessel.
That was why you were created, but what is your purpose now? Why are you alive? Why do you care to keep on existing? Yeah, that's right. I'm going to throw it right back in your face like a fish.
Damn!
He doesn't need D. Actually, I guess he does need D because he's still got human skin.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no, I got the photosynthesized, so all I have to do is be in light. So,
I mean, it's good to have D in order to get the things you need, but...
Yeah, I mean, I have to be in and around the D, but, you know, I'm more or less good at... So
you literally have D in your blood?
Yeah. I am fueled by the D.
But what is your purpose?
So, like, what is your purpose after that?
Listen, I'll go Pirates of the Caribbean if you want. What is your purpose here?
What would I be doing? So I just like end up like find myself in an alleyway on like floor 15 of the volcano scrapped. I'm just like, what am I doing? So actually that could be something that we try to find as I guess my main purpose at the moment would be.
I mean, so your purpose is you don't know, which is a legitimate answer to the question.
Yeah, he just doesn't know. So why am I alive? I guess that's why I'm acting.
Perfect. All right. Let's do some geary stuff for people, right?
Sure, yeah, let's tie them and then get going.
Yeah, yeah. So, if anyone wants to start asking their geary questions.
Let's see.
I'd ask mine, I don't know what questions to ask, though.
It's top left of the second sheet.
Okay. Yeah. So after you introduce your character, read the questions aloud and ask volunteers. If they agree, mark Geary and discuss details of what occurred. When you cash in Geary, reference the details. So the first question is, if someone else knows of your past and keeps it secret for you to maintain your status, they have one Geary on you.
So does anyone know that he is like... There's some secret of your past that we need to keep secret?
He didn't say how he got here.
Okay.
That's why. Yeah.
How I got where? Like
to the top. So no one knows that you're like a family member of this company.
I mean, my name is Glasscock and it's Mizugumi.
It's literally on the wall.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but if somebody answers that, then you work together to like,
what about, if somebody knows of my past and keeps it secret for you, I'd imagine that would probably be Kip, if it would be anybody.
Yeah, because I'm the PI, right?
You're the PI empath. So like maybe one day we were working on a job together and you just brushed up against me.
You put two and two together and was like,
you know.
Well, what about...
Is Glasscock stuff? Is it?
what about, like, maybe you are Glasscock. The last cock and you killed them and then assumed their identity or something like that. Like maybe you
wanted the D so bad you had to take it from
I mean that would be interesting. Like all right, yeah, so like my character has actually infiltrated the Glasscock family. Like, I'm a distant cousin from a different world, apparently.
Oh, yeah. And you, like, rewrote everybody's memories. It's like Bleach. You're like, hey, what's up, guys? I was here all along. Oh, it's TV shows where you go back and you were like, I was in the background of all of those scenes of your life that are important.
Yeah, and like the glasscocks of this world are actually like, you know, tall sub-Saharan African men and women, and like I'm this little portly Eastern
No one
York
questions it.
Sure, sure, that's cool.
I don't know why that's.
So funny. I've got one Giri on you, which Giri moves. Like basically, I can. It's like leverage on somebody else that I can ask you to do stuff for me and like stuff like that.
All right. If someone knows you've skimmed off the top to get your own stuff done and hasn't told anyone, they have one Giri on you. This seems to make sense for Cid. We've done a job together and he saw me doing something illicit afterwards. I just threw him some creds and like, you know, just keep this to yourself for now. But you know that I'm not always above board with the things that I do. I threw you some D, you took it. I mean, you took all of it.
Yes, but you have to remember that I care not for the D.
That's why you got Giri, right?
Exactly. That's why like you refused my D. And so now that's an imbalance of honor between us.
Fisher, I want to thank you again so much for writing this RPG and then joining us for this, by the way. Mm. Best evening of the week, I'm sure. Possibly of your entire life.
If you run someone
you'll remember this forever.
He's never gotten this much D in a session before.
If you run someone as an exclusive asset for your own paying contracts, you have one Giri on them.
Yeah, I'll take that. Okay. I got some dirt on you.
No, that means I have one Giri on you.
Yeah, it means if he only uses you to give his dirty work.
Oh, I think that makes perfect sense. Oh, yeah.
You always go to Shamus, and so Shamus needs you for like a regular paying job.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense to me.
All right, cool. Well, Shamus, let's talk about you and your Giri.
I'm not seeing these on my
second
list.
Page. If you're looking on the Roll 20, it's right here.
Oh, so he's honor bound. He's right next to me. Oh my god, he's got such a big Giri.
Yeah, he's got huge Giri.
Yeah. I guess that is his whole class is not about.
Yeah, he gets Giri on other people at character creation rather than has to give it.
Oh, no.
He does to Giri what you do to the D.
Hmm. He just gobbles it all up as much as you can possibly get.
Wait, I'm still not seeing it.
Are you on Roll 20?
Yeah.
Okay, it's right here.
Shifting us.
Oh, there you go. If you've let someone off or reduce their penalty for breaking Giri previously. So like I had a moment of compassion and not killed, probably not killed 2.0 when I was supposed to. Or let him go.
No, so, not killed, I think is a good one.
Yeah.
So like he was escaping. And then,
Is this like 2.0's origin story flashback? You see, like, Shamus outside with the sword, and he sees this broken ass robot coming out, and he's like, feel really bad.
Well, it might be like one of those things. Maybe not escaping, but it might have been that he just found me in one of like the lower levels in a trash heap or something other like that, instead of just taking me out once he realized what I was. Because he hates the D so much, and I am literally fueled by it. So I owe one Giri to you?
Yeah.
Okay.
And when he cashes that in, you better pay, because he's the Giri enforcer, so he'll literally murder you.
He's the Giri enforcer.
He's like, listen, I need you to do this thing for me. And you're like, no. And he's like, I'm going to call him the Giri. And you're like, actually, I'm super busy right now. And is your sword sticking out of my neck? This is really uncomfortable.
Well, no. Like, when you think about it, like, it might end up being that, like, he's my reins, if you would, of some form or fashion, because he is the one weapon that's superbly suited for killing me.
That's
true. Makes me stronger.
You got two other Giri questions there, Shamus.
Let's see. If you train someone to fend for themselves when you're not around, you have one Geary on them.
That could also be fucking 2.0.
Yeah.
You had the Mulan scene just, with him.
But just let him go, though. Then probably
he
not.
Was like he was walking around in like 2 year, like 2 years past fashion, and you're like, no, this will not do. You must wear the most latest brand.
It could be me, though. I'm a PI. Maybe it makes sense that since I'm part of the company, that you're like, okay, maybe you shouldn't get wrecked out there. Here's a couple moves.
Okay, I'll me accept too. That. And if someone keeps a secret regarding why you enforce Geary and has told no one.
Harvey Glasscock.
I think Harvey Glasscock knows all. He's done extensive research on you and your family. And has chosen you to be his. I mean, you're his leg breaker. You know, he's got to have.
You work exclusively for him.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah.
So what is the secret guarding why you enforce Geary? Do I need to know that? Do I need to have that, like, actual
information? Usually, like, when you're going to collect this with them, you'd be like, hey, like, I know this shit, so do this.
I think some form of past event that makes me feel shame.
So maybe, like, what if it was a job that went wrong? Like, it's a job we were supposed to do together, just a simple retrieval operation, and instead a couple people got killed, maybe, like, a child or a minor. And you're broken up about it.
Yeah, I was thinking about maybe I accidentally killed a kid when I was sent in to take somebody else out.
Right. And so I was like, oh, no, don't worry. I'll pay to have this all covered up.
And like that face-off moment where he goes to shoot the cop and ends up hitting the kid on the other side of him.
Exactly. I mean, you do have the only gun that can probably kill people in one shot in this entire hive. So
yeah.
All right. I got it.
Perfect. All right. Who wants to go next on the Geary table?
I can.
All right.
So this one kind of goes hand in hand with Seamus. If someone found you, built you, modified you since you were discovered, they have one Geary on you. So I was thinking that Seamus would have found me. So that's just one Geary he has towards me.
You down with that, Seamus?
Yeah.
I see you none. Okay.
So it might have been you found me, decided not to kill me, and then I just ask you a bunch of questions.
If you're going to survive down here... You're going to need some D.
And then I need somebody who I confided my current view of humanity with. And I'm thinking the empath might be a good way for that to come in. Because you might be curious about, you're not a human. How do you feel?
Yeah, like maybe it's nice like whenever we hang out. Because then I don't have to like feel all your shit all the time, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's like. I'm literally just a blank slate and it's just an assessment on humanity and my interaction until I grow and develop emotions.
Totally.
What are those things from Blade Runner? The Voight Comp machine tests?
Yeah.
You're literally a living version of that. And so when you get in your 2.0, you're like, oh, it's so glorious. He doesn't have emotions. Oh.
And then... if I try to emulate somebody else's outlook on humanity, they have one Geary on me. So I'm trying to emulate Mr. Glasscock there.
Are you serious? You've just been watching me, like creepily stalking me.
Well, no, it, like maybe it ended up being that
eye lasers to Cylon you.
Well, no, it's like one of the features I have for my eyes is like a HUD. So maybe it's just like I'm tapped into the matrix and I can see people's D worth. So I'm seeing Harvey Glasscock as one of the most prominent members of D. And so I want
some of the biggest D arounds.
Yeah, you check his rankings on the leaderboard that you maintain. He's pretty high up there.
Yeah, well, I like to imagine that, like, maybe I have, like, some type of connection with the Veil or, like, that giant Mega D block that's going down the volcano.
Well, out of everyone here, you'd be the most, like, connected kind of thing as, like, an artificial life form, probably. So.
Yeah, so basically I found him, and now I'm just kind of studying him as one of the most prominent members of the society.
Cool.
All right, Kip, let's talk about your D. I mean, I know we're supposed to talk about Geary, but I feel like throwing that question out there is way more weighted.
Yeah. If you overexerted yourself using the flow and someone saved you from a dicey situation, they have one Geary on you. Anybody save me?
I mean, I feel like if anybody would be doing that, it'd probably be Seamus.
Yeah.
I would actually say 2.0 might step in to save you, but...
That's true.
You seem like you might be chill bros.
Yeah, maybe like... We went to, like, I was like, hey, let's go to the volcano raid, bro. And then, like, it got out of hand, and I was like, oh, these people. And you're like, oh, this guy's collapsed. Let's grab him and leave before he gets the shit kicked out of him or something.
Okay.
Those Vicentic volcano ice raves can get
pretty out of hand. Matrix, right? So.
Yeah.
If you use the flow to comfort someone through an event in their life without telling anyone else about it, you have one gear on them.
Seamus killing child. Seamus killing child.
All right.
Yeah, that makes sense. And then if you use the flow to take solace or comfort in each other in a time of need for both of you, you each get one Geary on both of you. Like, you trade Geary.
And you know who that's with, right?
I mean, it doesn't have to be with me. It doesn't have to be with Mr. Glasscock Esquire.
I feel like Mr. Glasscock has a lot to give.
I mean, Mr. Glasscock, he is not really discriminating when it comes to how he gets more D. So,
sure. I mean, love is love in the future, man.
All right, so I got a nice little.
What do you mean, love is love in the future? We're talking about vitamin D that you get from sunlight.
All right, so Kip has 2 on me. I have 1 on him. Seamus has 1 on me. I have 2 on him. And then I have 1 on 2.0.
Right? That's what we're talking about, right? I'm not missing any, you know,
subtext.
Pretty sick innuendos.
Yeah. So we're all ready. We kind of already have this story going on.
Yeah. You're very involved in everybody's lives. So, I think that there's this guy named John Baptiste Ulrich Jr. who owns and is the leader of, like, the Ulrich family. And they created 2.0, and now they want him back now that he's a big deal. But, you know, they tossed him out the door like he was garbage. So they don't actually own him, and maybe that's where all the Geary comes into effect. Like, they're like, we own you. And 2.0 is like, no, you don't own me. And Seamus is like, yeah, you don't own him. We're going to wreck you. And so Glasscock has been asked on behalf of Mizugumi, Shekelstein, and Glasscock to intervene. So I think maybe, is this like the opening scene? Is all of you sitting in a room that's in and out of, it's in the veil, right? So it's, you're sitting on 4 chairs, and then we get the boop, 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 boop of hologram emitters of, like, being in the veil, and you're sitting at, like, a Death Star array in the Rebel Fleet headquarters, like a giant picture of someone's floating head is there, and it's like, yeah. Something like that. We good starting there?
Sure, yeah. All right, so do you want to do starting moves?
Oh yeah, we should definitely open starting moves because I think a couple of you have them.
Definitely executive.
Yeah, I got a starting move, baby.
At birth, we already did.
You have quarterlies, right?
Yeah, 3. Well, I have to roll.
Right, you have your quarter. Your capital is +2 for your corporation. So you get +2 to your quarterlies roll.
Okay. So I just rolled 2d6 +2.
Yep.
It looks like a low roll.
That's good for you, I think.
Oh, is it?
Right? On a miss, the board assigns you 3 mandatory contracts. Today. Yeah. I mean, that's what's going to happen here. I mean, that's immediately what's going to happen.
And you can, it's worth noting that these 3 contracts could be one job with 3 different, like, stepping stones of him.
The board then gives you funds for every contract up front and expects it to be done in the amount of time described by me. Okay. Does anybody else have a starting session move?
Just the honor bound needs to choose what kind of mission they're on. That's about it.
Yep. A bound move. When you begin a session without a task involving the enforcement of Geary that's been broken. I feel like that's what we're doing, though. We're literally...
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
We are starting a session with broken Geary because John Baptiste Ulrich Jr. was supposed to take care of 2.0 and then trashed him and is now like, you belong to me. He literally sends you a gif of Taylor Swift where it's like, you belong with me. And it's him singing karaoke because karaoke is super popular.
The way that I like to imagine it is that I never activated. Like, maybe they were testing it out with a fake cyber brain and it never worked. So just we're going to scrap this project. And then they learn of me actually fully functioning and they want to know why. So they want me back so that they can continue on and make 3.0.
All right. So Giant Floating Head resolves into the oldest person in Mizugumi, Shekelstein, and Glasscock. So a very respected individual. He's filled with D. Not only does he glow with a lot of vitamin D, he's also got Donald Trump orange skin lotion. So his name is Mizugumi, and he's the Giant Floating Head is him, and there's a bonsai emblem behind him. And he's Glasscock-san.
Mizugumi-san, we are very, very honored to see you today.
There's no reason to use that incredibly offensive accent with me.
I get nervous, and then you're just so intimidating with your glowing skin and your huge D.
I understand many people are afraid that they might be rivaled by my D with it being so large. Shamus-kun, Kip-kun, and 2.0-chan, you are all there as well. Excellent.
It is good to see you. It seems your D levels are well over 9,000.
Yes, I like to keep at least 9,000 D in the bank at all times. 9,000 in one. Now, John Baptiste Ulrich Jr. has attempted to put out a contract on you. 2.0. I am asking that this organization immediately move to protect you from any further harm, while also moving in to blackmail the surviving members of the Ulrich family. John Baptiste Ulrich himself, of course, must be killed immediately.
Please, there is no need for violence.
He just ignores you and looks at Harvey, and it just repeats the line, and it's just John Baptiste Ulrich Jr. must be killed immediately. Wakari Masenka?
Yeah, see all your boss. Yeah, look, 2.0, we're gonna have to kill these guys. It's just what happened when you're human. You want to be human, right?
I am not allowed to cause any inaction or action that would harm a human being.
Don't worry. Seamus will take care of it. He's got his gun, and it shoots those old-timey bullets. It'll be perfect.
If you wish to harm another human being, please keep me out of this.
Oh, yeah. Don't worry. We're not going to actually harm anybody. We're just going to have you go out of the room, and then we're going to talk to him really loud for a while.
Allow 2.0 to assist you in the blackmailing part of this.
Yeah, we got it, boss. We got it. Don't micromanage all the time.
Yeah, he emails you 5 credits. I don't know how this works. Oh, I got it. Okay, this vacuum tubes everywhere throughout the place, and literally 5 things of vitamins come through a vacuum tube, and he's like, "Your payment has already been sent, Glasscock-san. You must resolve this within the next 48 hours."
48 hours? They need at least 96.
No, that's ridiculous. 48 hours is fine.
You're always busting my balls, Mizugumi. Come on.
I think Kip is in the back, and he's got a UV cigarette or something. And he's like, yeah, I can find him, old man. And flicks it at the hologram face.
All right, it goes through his face, and he's like, very well then, Kip-san. Mizugumi out. And he disappears, and maybe the hologram world starts fading a little bit. So you can still see that you're in a blank room in 4 chairs, but you also kind of see the overlay of a really nice Death Star recreation. Really cool. Fucked up.
So whoever made it is a huge nerd.
Yeah, I mean, this is Cyber Iceland, so.
I spent a lot of time on this overlay.
All right, boys. So look, we got to go find this John Baptiste Ulrich guy. And then once we get him out of the way, not say we're going to kill him 2.0. But once Seamus permanently takes care of him, I'm going to give a big stage wink to Seamus. If you know what I mean.
We'll take him to the farm again.
Yeah. Take him up the stack to the farm at the top.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
You'll be real happy there. You'll just be running with all the other puppies and stuff.
That's me. 2.0, it's worth noting that you have a move at your disposal called Analyze, as well as Probe, which is like you could study him and see if he's like bullshitting you or not. Basically, it's a basic move that everybody has. But it depends what your character's doing. I don't know if that's. Yeah.
Well, probably. I don't think he's really doing much yet. But he'd probably like say to that comment, "We're going up to the farm. Oh, may I join you? I would very much like to see the sun someday."
Yeah. Well, all in good time. Seamus, do you know anybody who can help us track down these Ulrich people?
I will see what I can do to leverage my contacts to find this person so I may end his life.
If you need any help with leverage, I've got some leverage I can press up against people that they're not going to like. It's going to make them feel real bad for a while, but in the end, it'll get the job done.
Well, I think you guys know that Kip in the past, like, you know that he, like, goes to the person's house to, like, do his thing, but you don't know what it is or whatever, so he'll probably, like, go do that.
Wait, where is Kip going?
I want to go to the guy's like house or whatever. So I want to like. Did we get? I assume we got like the information on the guy enough that we.
No, I think he just like told you the guy's name. They expect a private investigator to you know be capable of finding out more.
I'd like to lift right now, Arthur Perkins.
Okay, cool. Yeah,
I'd like to lift a veil for 500, please.
Okay, tell me how lifting the veil works. You're right, trying to access the internet or something, or what's going on?
I mean, I would say Harvey Glasscock. I didn't get a cybernetics. I got an eye slot with the HUD recording device and magnification, and he's addicted to taking pictures of everything, like everything, like Instagram, basically. Like every cup of coffee, drink.
You do the opposite of a selfie. You just take pictures of everything you're looking at. You're like blink, 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 blink,
and upload them constantly to my.
Got it. Your Google Glass, Glasscock.
Oh, that's what I was thinking of too, and I had to mute myself because I was losing my shit.
Yep.
Right. Yeah, so I'm gonna lift the veil. I'm probably gonna try if I can't directly just like think of the information.
Okay, you're gonna like check your past photos and see if you've ever seen John Baptiste.
Yeah, I mean, well, these are important people. I'm sure that our firm has done some business with them in the past.
Sure. How do you feel about this right now?
I mean, right now I feel like he hasn't been crushed by his older brother or by anybody in Mizugumi, Shekelstein, and Glasscock over the past couple of days. He's feeling pretty powerful, especially over these.
Okay.
He has a much higher D. Like, his D is much larger than theirs.
Okay, you get a hit. So I believe you mark 1 point of powerful, right?
Okay.
He didn't get a hit, though. He, like, failed hard, didn't he?
You got seven.
Seven.
So that's, like, the mid-ground. 7 through 9, 10 plus is the hit. So isn't this the point where he, like, it's a partial success and partial failure?
Yep.
Well, how come it says 4 and a 7? That's weird.
4 is the last roll he made.
Oh, dear. Okay.
Yep. Okay, so, yeah, you get an impression. Yeah, so you have a couple pictures of John Baptiste Ulrich. You don't know exactly where he stays, but you do know that the Ulrichs all live in like, a space station-style sealed-off complex with airlocks and security guards. They mess with the gravity there sometimes. They don't let anybody in without business reasons. They're super xenophobic. They have weird cybernetic armatures that they use to construct stuff like 2.0. Mm-hmm. So you don't know where he's located within the Ulrich compound, but you know where the Ulrich compound is. It's located actually towards level 15, like as close to the bottom as you can get before Morlock territory.
Interesting.
I would like to reach out to my hacker friend to see if he can help find out where this guy is inside that compound.
Okay. Yeah, so what's your hacker friend's name again?
Oh, crap. What do we need? Bartleby.
Bartleby, yeah.
Yeah, you call Bartleby, and he's like, hello, this is Bartleby.
Bartleby, we're on a... I've been tasked with killing another person, and I need to find where he is located within the Ulrich compound, and I give him the guy's name.
I see.
Is there, like, a slur, though, in this future for killing somebody? Like
I need him erased.
Yeah. No,
burn.
Oh, burn. Yeah, I need to burn him. I need to give him a tan.
No, and I'll say it loudly right in front of 2.0.
What a dick. Yeah, so for those that haven't played Powered by the Apocalypse before, the GM or the Master of Ceremonies can only make a certain series of moves, and I feel like right now is the perfect time to make a particular move where Bartleby says, well, old chap, I'd be willing to do this for you, but I'm going to need a little something from you down the road. I don't work for free, you know, and with you being such a good enforcer of duty, I feel like I could use your services down the line. You don't mind if I keep you on my speed dial, do you?
Of course not, Bartleby. We've worked well together in the past.
Well then, give me a few hours and I'll send back everything I can find out about this...
What? Ulrich?
Ulrich, yes. I'll see what I can do for you.
Ulrich von Liechtenstein?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah. Do you want to cut to a few hours later when you get that info, or is there anything people wanted to do immediately?
Yeah, while this is going on, I'm kind of just not paying attention because I don't understand it. And what I'm going to be doing is I'm just going to be... kind of tapping into the veil and kind of witnessing people. So I'm hearing them at what I guess talk about violence. So I'm going to use the abyss stairs back to kind of look into humanity and violence to try and get some understanding of it.
Okay. So you're searching the vast accumulated knowledge of the veil. Wow. I don't know what happened.
Really well.
Yeah, you roll really good. You generate 2 humanity points. You can spend it to choose an option on Rise, ask any question from your special, or divulge a belief or truth about yourself in order to inflict humanity harm. You could literally go to your friends and just be like, I don't like it when you kill people. And they'll be like, no, that hurts me inside. Oh, tears me up.
Well, you have to say more than that. But
you're
yeah.
so judgmental, 2.0. You're like a child.
Well, no, since the main reason for this was... to try and find out about violence, I think I actually might use it to unlock powerful and mad. So I'm learning about the powerful and mad emotions.
Well, just one, right?
I got 2 humanity.
You got 2 points.
Oh, nice. Perfect. Sweet. Sick, sick.
So what stats are you assigning to powerful and mad?
0 until I improve them.
Okay. Unlock a new emotion. Oh, it says and assign a value to that state.
Yeah. It'll be like...
Well, no, it's like it's normally you choose the 2, 1, 1, 0, -1.
Oh, right.
I'm thinking that I just want to start off at the 0, so I'm just learning about powerful, like what the.
So you're literally only going to roll powerful and mad.
Well, no.
So you're going to be exactly like everybody else. You're like, I love power. Power makes me feel better.
Yeah.
I hate being mad.
I just discovered it. I just discovered the powerful.
Everybody in the room swinging their dicks around on their phones, and you're like, I want to do that too.
That's how my character's going to be. I'm learning from these 3. I mean,
wow,
AI.
Wow, that's terrifying. You guys are horrible role models.
Yes,
we are.
So I shine a light on that.
If I agree with that, I think Harvey Glasscock is a perfectly fine role model for humanity.
Yeah. Oh, shit.
I'm not, but I don't care.
Yeah.
Right, so we all sort of like sit around this table and like are just fiddling around our phones, like looking for information.
Yeah,
I'm just sitting there cleaning my gun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I wanna try like searching the veil for this person too, but I think it might make sense to try to use the link move to generate a contact about it.
Okay.
So link move.
So you're introducing a new NPC into the game by name with a look and an outlook. You tell me how you know them and how you feel about them.
So I think that they are, I bet it's like it's an ex-lover that we'll see exactly what the relationship's like now, but it ended because of the Glasscock and me.
Mm.
Yeah. They found out about it.
Yep.
It was just, that got wrecked. And then for feeling wise, probably something like
hot blooded. Check in to see. No? Okay.
Probably sad. Because I'm like crawling back to the ex for like info kind of deal.
I can't believe that's rough for a private detective too. You're like, oh, I don't have any other leads.
Within the feeling wheel of sad is bashful, so so I'm gonna do that up.
All right, 7.
So strained or frayed in some way, and they have one Geary on me.
Oh no, not one Geary.
And then, let's see, I'll build her. I think that she's like femme. She wears like designer wear. She's got a sweet face, wistful eyes, and a willowy body. And I think that she's a bitch.
Okay.
And her name will be
Petunia.
Sure.
All right. Yeah. So you call her up and she's just like, Kep, what do you want?
Well, I know that we said that we were quits, baby, but I just need one more favor.
Yeah, we're definitely quits.
Like, just one more favor, though. I mean, you remember
you
that time?
You already owe me, Kep.
Yeah, but I mean, that's like a social constraint that was placed on us.
You're asking for another social constraint to be placed on you. It's called a restraining order, weirdo.
Let's see. I would like, her motivation. I wanna be like, okay, fine. If not for me, do it for me. Tell me where this guy is.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear any of that. Something like washed you out real quick. You said do it for
for 2 cred, and then we'll be square.
You're offering 2 cred now for her to do this plus wipe out your Geary? Or just for this?
Just for this, yeah.
All right, she's like, yeah, fine, whatever. I need to work on my Tamin anyway.
Yeah, so then I give her the name or whatever, and I'll call like how do we get around elevator or whatever, right? So I'll be like talking to, I'll be like that obnoxious guy in the elevator who's like talking to his ex-girlfriend, making small talk, and everyone's like,
oh, you're horrible.
This guy.
Right? All right, yeah, so you're in the elevator, and she's like, if you want to get into the Ulrich compound and like talk to John Baptiste Ulrich, this is a junior, you need to be like a better person than you are, Kip.
Okay.
He monitors the vitamin D levels of everyone around him, and he only surrounds himself with people with high levels of D.
Where I could do my thing, which is my thing is like recreating the crime scene to see like recreate shit, you know? So maybe if I can find a place where he's been before, I can just like tap into that.
Oh yeah, when you're like talking about your freaky ability, she's like, oh yeah, you use that on us way too often. Oh
yeah.
It's like trying to sniff my panties, freak. Anyway, if you want to go sniff John's panties. You just got to go to the arena and get in a couple fights. That's the only time people see him out in the open is when he goes down there to beat up robots.
Oh,
cool. Yeah. Okay. Sweet. Okay, I'll like... I think we'll end the scene with you can see me like flexing my, like the camera pans down and you see me flexing my my glove that stuns people, like getting all antsy to fuck people up kind of thing.
Yo, wait, what is with that glove you're already wearing? Like, what is that even thing you can do?
You'll find out soon enough.
Yeah, well, hey, look, if it's got some sort of like vibrating setting or something, and we can talk, but like it doesn't look like it's going to be particularly enjoyable.
I'll tell you later.
Are you talking?
You're still in the elevator. You're literally still in the elevator with like 10 people around you.
Yeah. And I'm just like, I'll tell you later. Stafu.
So after
I'm
you
just
guys
standing there shaking my head.
After you guys get off on a floor, Seamus, I'd love it if in the veil, like Skype still existed and projects like the person's face in front of you. And so, you know, you get that familiar like boo 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 ba boo ba.
Yeah, bring it up.
Okay, yeah, it's Bartleby, and he's like, "Well, old boy, I've got some information. Jean-Baptiste Ulrich II, his compound, he's located within the farthest reaches of it. However, there's a security maintenance tunnel you can access. All you have to do is get a janitor's badge and then use the under tunnels to travel at high speeds. There's some sort of weird gravity thing going on in there. And don't trigger the security system because they'll kill you. They're using some sort of gamma radiation shotgun thing.
All right,
oh, and they have combat droids. That's a thing too, apparently. Anyway, toodles.
Thank you again, Marley.
Yes, well, you owe me. Twice.
Once.
He just hangs up.
I like to, I think something neat might be is that like 2.0 kind of exists within the veil and the physical world mostly. So it's like when he's having this conversation, he's able to just look over and just see the person he's talking to, even though it's like his own connection type deal, just because he's interlocked. So he's just kind of studying everything that's going on. I'm trying to understand humanity.
I'll be like, well.
You also got to talk, or which means you also got to see, Petunia.
So, well, like, we have a location and a way in. We must find a janitor and kill them.
Clearly.
And I'm going to like look at 2.0. We got to talk to them and maybe, what do we need? Like, we need like their uniforms, their skin. Like, what about these janitors do we actually need to accomplish the mission?
Access badges.
Oh, it's easy.
So we kill them and take their badge.
Yeah, you're good at that kind of stuff. Yeah, so we go punch janitors real hard and they give us their access badges, and then what do we do?
We kill them.
No, we need to kill them. Look, if we kill him, then they don't produce any more ghee for the hive. All right, we need as much ghee as we can get out of these guys.
But they work for our opponents.
Remember, you're the people that everyone else goes to. So you still have to work with this family after you kill.
Yeah.
That's why you have to blackmail the rest of the Ulrichs.
If you don't want these people to die, then why did you call me?
Because I need you for the hard backup. You know, I need the solid length of your sword supporting us this entire time.
That you don't want me to kill anyone.
Not immediately, if it's necessary. Only if it's necessary.
I believe a former...
I don't even understand what's happening.
I believe it.
Look, Seamus, I give you lots of good D and good credits on top of that, all right? To do what needs to be done for the firm. And for my brothers, the Glasscocks. If this is too complicated, I'm sure I could find someone else who could go and buy some ancient relic and hurtle lead pellets at people like a savage.
Oh, wow. Damn, we're fucking burning tonight.
I feel an apt form of recourse may be able to be used. I saw when you were talking to that nice fellow there, Sid, Seamus, you talked about debts. Is there not some way that we could get this fellow to, Glasscock?
Oh, Glasscock's got strings everywhere. He can pull them like a spider. He can wrap you up in them, hang you from the ceiling, do whatever.
In the talks that Kip was having, it seemed he liked to spar at the arena. Maybe we could win over on him.
Oh, what if we... What if we kill him there? No, we don't kill anyone in the arena! Simpleton! No! We arrange for the fight to go the way we want it to, and then we approach him and let him know, hello, Mr. Ulrich. Perhaps you would be interested in making a lot of tea today.
To give him a false sense of security before we kill him. Yes, I understand.
I don't know why I continue using you.
Anytime you hear, like, it's like the iPhone where you can, like, make an acronym become something else, and we just substitute kill for go to the farm.
He can't die, right? He can't die while we're right there next to him and while the garbage compactor is here with us.
Is that what you call 2.0?
Wow.
God damn.
The garbage
case. All right. I feel like that's a perfect place to take a break.
Sure.
This is our one and only break tonight. Thank you for joining us so far. We'll be back for another 2 hours of filling you with D. As much D as you can handle and more.
I've got some various notes here, but my biggest note is, like, all in bold, arena robot fights.
Yeah, arena robot fights. I mean... That I did that for various reasons.
Definitely.
So good.
Like testing 2.0.
I think you'll like the combat system a lot more.
Okay. Well, we'll be back in about 7 minutes. So hold on to your butts and prepare to get a shower of D on you.